Towards the end of the last lecture module, we noted that human beings as social creatures needed cooperative, cohesive, harmonious social groups in order to reap the benefits of their social interactions. And because of this, they evolved two fundamental sorts of biases, a bias towards cooperative behavior and a bias towards conformity with the group. We said that arguers could leverage these biases through category distortion in order to associate acceptance of a conclusion or rejection of a conclusion with the fundamental disposition to conform with the group and the group's opinions. We looked at a specific instance of that kind of appeal to the people with appeal to the people direct. With appeal to the people direct, the category distortion occurs through the dynamics of the group itself. The people come together. Apparent consensus seems to emerge around an idea or course of action. This creates a very real and powerful psychological pressure amongst the individual members of the group to conform to that apparent consensus. That pressure is psychologically relevant, but it will be logically irrelevant. It's not based on a careful evaluation of the evidence. It's not based on a prudent choice amongst possibilities. It is part of this fundamental bias to create a cooperative, coherent, cohesive, harmonious society so that you can reap the benefits that that kind of society can provide for an individual. It's not about forming beliefs that happen to be true or well advanced. Instead, the goal is a social cognition goal of achieving community, consensus, agreement, harmony, cohesion, cooperation, things of that nature. For this reason, appeal to the people direct can be a very powerful tool for generating consensus using these psychological pressures. That's why political parties still have conventions. That's why people still go to church on Sundays. It is, however, a rather inefficient means of accomplishing these goals. It takes a tremendous amount of resources to gather people together to manage the dynamics of a group to try and bring it to that point of apparent congealing around a consensus. It takes logistics and money and time to do all that. And for that reason, people will oftentimes opt for appeal to the people indirect. Appeal to the people indirect takes a different tact. It says, look, I don't have the money or the time or the logistical know-how to gather people together and sculpt them into this ideal group that will be a vehicle for creating that psychological pressure. Instead, they say, look, I'm just going to point out to the world and I'm going to claim that that consensus already exists organically out there in the world. So when we think about appeal to the people indirect in the form of bandwagon, that's exactly the claim. The claim is, look, everyone agrees with this. Everyone believes this idea. This is what people want. This is what people believe. This is how people behave. And that can have a tremendous power. Lots of advertising is based on this idea. So Disney or Apple or Nike, they're all in the business of trying to convince you that they have the products that people really want, that people all agree how great their products are. Similarly, politicians are always trying to convince you that they are the ones who are ahead of a movement. They're the ones who have the popular support behind them. They're the ones that everyone likes or agrees with and so on. And so bandwagon is one way of appeal to the people indirect. It's much less logistically and cost intensive, but it can have a similar impact if done well. What about appeal to the people indirect snobbery? This is a slightly nuanced version of that same basic instinct. The idea here is I don't just want to conform with the group as a whole. The people who I really want to conform with, the people who I really want to have productive, harmonious relationships with, are the people who are highest in the social hierarchy, the people who are in a position to benefit me the most. And so as a result, appeal to the people indirect snobbery tries to associate acceptance of a belief or adoption of a course of action with adherence with the beliefs or desires or courses of action adopted by those people in the highest rungs of the social hierarchy. Now, I did a perverse, inverted, snobbery version of that argument. I suppose that no one thinks that serial killers are very high up in the social hierarchy. No one really wants to be having meaningful interactions with serial killers on a regular basis. They don't see the benefit of being Ted Bundy's best friend. You can use that desire not to have social interactions with those people to be a snob in the other direction, to form an argument like this. You know, suppose I ask you, what political view should you adopt? What should you feel about voting rights, or how should you feel about abortion, or so on? Well, just remember that serial killers overwhelmingly vote Republican and espouse traditional Republican views. Now, this isn't actually empirically true, but it does create this negative connotation that effectively generates that psychological pressure to avoid adopting those beliefs, not because they are poorly advanced or because the arguments for them are inadequate, but because one doesn't want to be part of that group. It's how we want other people to perceive us that drives the next form of appeal to the people indirect. That is the appeal to the people indirect vanity. The idea behind appeal to the people indirect vanity is that people want to be perceived as manifesting those properties that people admire and appreciate in other individuals. And because of that, you associate those properties with the acceptance of a particular conclusion, or the rejection of a particular conclusion, or the adoption of a particular course of action, or the rejection of that course of action. Oftentimes, finding people who exemplify particular property, things that people admire, and then getting them to be your spokesperson is an easy way to commit the fallacy of appeal to the people indirect vanity. So Albert Einstein, who's probably rolling over in his grave right now, says, like, I've been paid to tell you that smart, informed people like myself believe everything that Wallace says. And this is what's behind celebrity endorsements and sports figures endorsements and so on. The idea that they have these fantastic properties. They are these people that people admire. They are these people that are admired for their abilities, their skills, properties that they possess. And I want those properties too. So I can somehow share in that by sharing in the activities they engage in, sharing in the beliefs they engage in, and so on.
I can whoop anything on two legs, but even me, the greatest, needs help beating things with six legs. I mean roaches. I'm gonna show you how you can whoop roaches with Decon Power, Decon Forgone.
It's not like regular sprays. Forgone is an automatic room fogger. It wipes out roaches in the whole room. I don't want you living with roaches. Wipe them out with Decon Power. Decon, more power to you.
So at this time in 1979, Muhammad Ali was one of the best boxers that was active at that time. He was articulate. He was funny. He was admired by people all around the world. And here he is doing a roach commercial. Not because people think, oh yes, well, Muhammad Ali knows all about roaches. But instead, people think Muhammad Ali is this fantastic guy that everyone admires. I want to be like Muhammad Ali. If he uses this roach killer, maybe I should try that roach killer too. The last class that we'll look at under this rubric of appeal to the people indirect is us versus them arguments. And us versus them arguments seem to have a quite different flavor. And that's not because they operate in a fundamentally different way, but because the dynamics that is inherent in all of these arguments is displayed in its most ugly manifestations. In each of the previous examples, whether it was direct appeal to the people, whether it was vanity, whether it was bandwagon, whether it was snobbery, these were all focused on the desire to have cooperative interactions with people, harmonious interactions with people, coherent social groups. And that was all the positive aspect of this basic need that human beings have. The other side of that need, the negative side, the side that we oftentimes don't want to talk about, is the side that says, I want to be part of this group. And because I want to be part of this group, I want to dissociate myself from this group. Because I'm part of this group, I'm antagonistic towards that group. It pulls us apart. It separates us as well as uniting us. We're united with this group. That implies that we're separated from this group. It's this fundamental distinction between belonging and rejection. We don't want to be part of that group. We want to be part of this group. And that's why the us versus them example seems so antagonistic, so negative, so hateful, because they are a reflection of the opposite side of the desire to belong. The desire to belong also implies the desire to reject. Purveyors of us versus them seek to use our very desire to cooperate and to cohere to pull us apart, to divide us and to distract us.